Hello and welcome to Encounter. Thanks for joining with us. Will you sing along? Oh, in your presence, our fear is crumbling, and in your freedom, we are awakening. Spirit, move in me. Use my hands and feet. All right. Alive again, and in your kingdom, you make a citizen. Spirit, move in me, use my hands and feet. This is our prayer together, like a fire. Like a fire, burning brighter, like an anthem, getting louder. We're your people, oh, and we're rising. Surrendering, Spirit, move in me, use my hands and feet. I count on one thing, the same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will. Valley, yes, I will bless your name. Oh, and yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing. I count on one thing. The same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. The waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things out.
Family, thank you for joining me here. I know many of you have been watching online for a long time, and I get really encouraged when I run into some of you and you tell me about the fact that you have been watching online, because obviously this is getting old and I really understand that. It's certainly, I feel your exhaustion with watching online. I've been tired of Zoom calls and certainly tired of filming online as well, but I am glad for this technology, even though it's not as good as being in person, and also want to just invite you to come be with us in person if you can. On Sunday morning at 9 or 10:45, we're having great services outside, and love to have you part of that. Well, we're continuing our series, this New Kingdom People series. It's a look at what Jesus taught about his kingdom, what that kingdom reign would look like in our lives. It is happening now in us as the King comes to reside in our heart, and it is something that's going to be fully realized when the new heaven and new earth is set up by our King. But for now, we're learning what it means to live into this, to be these new kingdom people. In one sense, the kingdom of God comes to us, it's given to us. When we receive him, we receive his grace, and he enters into our lives by his Spirit, the kingdom is planted in us. But it is also an invitation to keep pursuing this as a lifestyle. So I want you to think with me today about this third of the Beatitudes. We've been in this for a few weeks now, and if you've missed any of that, I would encourage you to go back and just check it out, because it's a whole sermon. We're just sort of picking it out in sections and looking at each section, because each one is so important, so dense in a sense. Picture with me where Jesus is at this point, somewhere north of the Sea of Galilee, on a mountainside. Jesus has gone there with his followers, and he is teaching them, probably in some kind of a natural amphitheater. And there is a natural amphitheater right there in on the coast, right at the north side of the Sea of Galilee, where I've been, and actually had the opportunity of teaching some people there myself, and it's really, really something how this creates this natural bowl. That could have been where Jesus is teaching. as he says these words that we find in Matthew chapter 5. So you can make your way there, and we see the beginning part of this Sermon on the Mount, this section called the Beatitudes, because over and over he talks about these people being blessed. In other words, it's well with them. God's shalom covers them, fills them. They are blessed, even though they may be suffering now. And he makes these comparisons with the kingdom of this world, which is all about wealth and power and putting down other people to get ahead and so forth. He says it's not like that in the kingdom of God. Everything is turned around. Things are different. And as we're going to see today, he says those that are proud and those that think they have it all together are not the ones who are going to be blessed in the kingdom of God. Interesting. Have you ever seen a dead pufferfish? I became kind of intrigued with these little animals when I was walking on the beach along the Sea of Cortez on the east side of Baja, Mexico. I was walking along, and every once in a while I would come across this little dead pufferfish laying in the sand, like a little deflated beach ball just laying there. Apparently this pufferfish had puffed its last puff, and I walked along and there it was. I came home and did a little research on these things. They're called by a number of different names. They go by pufferfish or blowfish, balloonfish, globefish, swellfish, but whatever they're called, they're full of toxins. I found out that within minutes of ingesting their poison, victims go from nausea to paralysis, loss of consciousness, respiratory failure, and sometimes even death. Imagine this little, you know, bulbulous fish causing so much destruction. But I couldn't help but notice the parallel with pride, how we get full of ourselves, we get puffed up, but it's really poisonous, both to ourselves and to other people. Peter quotes Proverbs 31 when he says in his letter that God is opposed to those who are proud. Just think about that for a moment. Let that sink in. God is opposed to those who are proud. Man, the last thing I need is for God to be opposed to me. So this is very, very important for us to think about today. God is opposed to our pride. Why? Well, I began to think about some of the toxins of pride, things like entitlements about how things should be to our own benefit, a compulsion to look better than others, anger at God when he doesn't do things our way, indignation with others when they don't do what we want, unwillingness to forgive or offer grace when people fail, using people to our own ends, or selfishness about money or accolades or some other commodity that we want. Interestingly, God has ways of giving us an out. It's kind of an antidote to these toxins of pride. Things like humbling circumstances and failures, difficulties we can't solve, people we can't control, prayers that don't get answered the way we expected, things we don't understand about God or the universe, losses that remind us of our own limitations, and all sorts of other ways that we're reminded that we are not God. He uses all those things, if we allow him, to change our character and kind of strip us down and help us to realize we can see, in fact, through some of those things, our own tendency toward pride. And they relieve us of that. They kind of give us space to come back to who we really are. Christ invited people into this spiritual kingdom. It's a place where everything's a little different. We start by recognizing our need for God, our need for a Savior, Jesus Christ. And then we repent of our self-sufficiency. He said, blessed are those who are mourning, meaning we recognize who we are, and it causes us grief. We're sad over who we are. And then, thirdly, what we're going to look at today, he says in Matthew 5:5, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Think about that. Blessed are the meek. We tend to think that those who have the power, those who have the money, they're the ones who get the most. But here, Jesus is saying, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. The word translated here as meek is the Greek word praus. It's a word that actually means, or it's translated also as gentle in the New Testament. Jesus is not saying blessed are the wimpy, but rather blessed are those who have strength, but strength that's under control. The Greek word was actually used of strong horses that had been tamed and trained and were, because of that, restrained. So it's literally meaning power under control. Jesus seldom uses any adjectives to describe himself, but when he does, the first word he uses is this Greek word praus. He says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle," there's the word, "and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." That word gentle and humble there can be used almost interchangeably. My favorite book of 2020 was Dane Ortlund's book, Gentle and Lowly, The Heart of Christ for Sinners and Sufferers. And in there he writes this, meek, humble, gentle. Jesus is not trigger happy, not harsh, reactionary, easily exasperated. He is the most understanding person in the universe. The posture most natural to him is not a pointed finger, but open arms. The meaning of the word lowly overlaps with that of gentle, together communicating a single reality about Jesus' heart. The point in saying that Jesus is lowly is that he is accessible. For all his resplendent glory and dazzling holiness, his supreme uniqueness and otherness, no one in human history has ever been more approachable than Jesus Christ. No prerequisites, no hoops to jump through. That really describes him pretty well. I want to look at or think about three considerations with you, okay? As we think about this idea of meekness and gentleness and those people inheriting the earth, what does that mean? Well, just three things I'd love for you to hang on to here. The first is this: a true alignment with Jesus will always result in a logical sort of personal humility. Think about that. A true alignment with Jesus will always result in a logical sort of personal humility. You see, what is so often considered strength in our culture is frequently seen in Scripture as weakness. And what is seen as weakness in Scripture is, according to Jesus, actual strength. Numbers 12:3 in the Old Testament refers to Moses as being the man who was very, very humble, more humble than anyone on earth. And yet this humble man is a man who stood up to Pharaoh, the most powerful man in the known world, and who led more than a million people through the desert for 40 years. So he was very strong, and yet it says he was humble. It's no accident that in the story, The Lord of the Rings, the heroes are hobbits or halflings. Hobbits are little people, just like 3 to 4 feet tall, and most of the people outside of the Shire never even knew they existed. Yet these little weak people were the heroes. They were the center of all these great events that brought about the overcoming of evil. And there's this great statement in the story made by Elrond, one of the great leaders of the elves. And he said this, listen carefully. "The road must be trod, but it will be very hard. Neither strength nor wisdom will carry us far upon it. This quest may be attempted by the weak with as much hope as the strong. Yet such is oft the course of deeds that move the wheels of the world. Small hands do them because they must, while the eyes of the great are elsewhere." Powerfully put. The heroes in this story don't want power. They just want to bring about what is good and true, and they're willing to fight for that no matter what it costs them. Our English word humility, think about the etymology of that word. The root of that comes from our same word as humus, or meaning fertile ground or of the ground. Literally, to be human is to realize that we are from dust, we return to dust. In Luther's words, humility is the decision to let God be God. It's a reckoning with who we really are. And it can be very hard for us because we tend to be addicted to ourselves. We tend to think that the whole world revolves around us and our comfort. Donald Miller writes in his great book, Blue Like Jazz, he says, "I hear addicts talk about their shakes and panic attacks and highs and lows of resisting their habit. And to some degree, I understand them because I've had habits of my own. But no drug is so powerful as the drug of self. No rut in the mind is so deep as the one that says, I am the world. The world belongs to me. All people are characters in my play. There is no addiction so powerful as self-addiction. I would agree. In reality, we are not the center of anything. Sometimes we react to people as if we think we are, and we tend to view the world as if everyone else is there for our own comfort. But in truth, that's just a lie. That's just an illusion. Think about the way Paul referred to himself. Just listen to the humility in these words. Now, remember, Paul, the Apostle Paul, he was chosen by God, had a vision of Jesus Christ. When given all these revelations that he was to write down for the church and all this wisdom and understanding of what the Old Testament was about and all of that, on top of all of his training as a Pharisee and as a teacher of the law and so forth, and yet he writes this in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 9. He says, I don't even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. He says, I am just nobody, but God's grace has been poured over my life, and it has had a great effect on me. But notice his humility. He recognizes everything is from God. So a true alignment with Jesus always results in a logical sort of personal humility. And there's a second thing I think we need to think about. Humility creates a different mindset about my strengths and weaknesses, my overall self-perception, a different mindset about my strengths and my weaknesses. I had the privilege of doing much of my postgraduate work under a man, a professor, a psychologist named Dr. Bruce Naramore. And he wrote this, I think it's really well put. He said, true humility could best be defined as seeing and accepting ourselves as God sees and accepts us. True humility recognizes that we are finite creations of an almighty God and that he has created us with many abilities. But it also recognizes our failures and our needs. True humility recognizes our strengths as well as our weaknesses and is not preoccupied with either one. People with a solid sense of self-esteem do not have to keep evaluating their worth because they have a settled identity. They get on with life and serving others. Reminding me of that bumper sticker that says, you are special, just like everyone else. Many in the first century believed that the mark of a great leader was power and being charismatic and having this amazing vocabulary and having an attractive personality. That's what made a great leader. And Paul really objected to that. He kept reiterating over and over that that's not actually great leadership in the kingdom of God. In fact, the church at Corinth just kind of dismissed Paul because he didn't have all that they felt like a super leader should demonstrate. So in his second letter to the church at Corinth, Paul said, what you think leadership should look like and what Christ says leadership should look like are two different things. Then he goes on to talk about his own persecutions and sufferings and weaknesses, and that those things actually qualified him to be someone that they should listen to. His point was that God does his best work, not through our strengths, but through our surrender to him because we recognize our inabilities and our non-strengths. James Stewart was considered the best preacher in the world in the earliest part of the 20th century. He was a preacher in Scotland, and he actually became later in life the chaplain to Queen Elizabeth. But he wrote these important words. He said, it is always upon human weakness and humiliation, not human strength and confidence, that God chooses to build his kingdom. And that he can use us not merely in spite of our ordinariness and helplessness and disqualifying infirmities, but precisely because of them. This great preacher was very, very humble, and he recognized it was God working through him that allowed him to have any influence at all. And this idea of God working through us as believers is a central theme throughout the New Testament. In fact, Jesus used that beautiful picture of like a grape vine, the main line of life, and then that life spreading out into the branches that were attached to the vine. It's like it's that attachment that gives us any fruitfulness. That was the point he was making. Here's the third I want you to catch. Third consideration. A humble mindset values the elevation and encouragement of others over self-preoccupation and personal comfort. Let me say that again. A humble mindset values the elevation and encouragement of others over self-preoccupation and personal comfort. Jesus opened sort of a proverbial 5-gallon can of worms that day he preached this Sermon on the Mount. And later in the sermon, he said this, Matthew 6, verse 1, "Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others, to be seen by them." Man, isn't there a tendency in us, I mean, I certainly see it in myself, to want others to recognize my goodness. I want them to see me as talented or want them to see me as well accomplished or impressive in some way. And yet, Jesus is warning against that. He says, be very careful. Don't practice your righteousness in a way that you're hoping people will notice you. It's quite a warning. Jesus gave 3 specific examples in Matthew 6. He said, when you give your offerings, just give to the Lord. Don't hope that people will see what you're giving. Don't announce it. Just be anonymous about it. And I notice it myself that when I give something to anyone, there's always this teeny little voice that says, I hope they'll notice. I hope they'll appreciate me for it. And Jesus is saying, no, don't do that. Just squelch that voice. Just give anonymously, give freely, give generously without worrying about how anybody responds. And secondly, he says, when you pray, it's a warning against being preoccupied with what we're saying or the words we're using or using impressive vocabulary. He says, no, when you pray, just pray to your Heavenly Father. Pray in secret. And when you're praying publicly, certainly don't make a display of it. Don't worry about the words. That's not what's important. Worry about what's in your heart. So when you give, when you pray, and then he says, when you fast. In other words, any kind of spiritual discipline that you're doing, do it privately. Don't do it to impress anyone else. C.S. Lewis, who wrote Mere Christianity, put it this way. He said, if we were to meet a truly humble person, we would never come away from meeting them thinking they were humble. They would not be always telling us they were a nobody. And then he adds, because a person who keeps saying they're a nobody is actually a self-obsessed person. The thing we would remember from meeting a truly gospel humble person is how much they seem to be totally interested in us. Because the essence of gospel humility is not thinking more of myself or less of myself, it is thinking of myself less. Blessed are the meek, Jesus said, for they will inherit the earth. What's he mean by inherit the earth? Or as he's put it in other places in this same section, the kingdom of heaven. Well, he's obviously making a reference to our future point of inheritance. There's a time when we're going to be in this new kingdom with a new heaven and a new earth, and this will all be our inheritance. But just think about that wording for a minute. They will inherit. You see, the world system is you've got to get, you've got to grab, you've got to climb. And Jesus is saying when we surrender to him, these things become ours. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. They will inherit the earth. That sounds a lot like we're just given those things. And in fact, we are. It's not about dominating and getting more. It's about surrendering to this king, allowing his life to more and more take over our life, and then thinking about what that means on a day-to-day basis. And in this case, it means lowering my pride, stripping myself of all those illusions that I'm somebody special and that the world revolves around me, and coming back to the fact that I am simply here by grace, and it's the life of Christ flowing through me that has any effect or any goodness in the world, and it's his grace that's having this great effect on me. That's what it means to lean into and rest in this grace of Christ, this grace of God poured out on us. So we come meekly and we inherit the earth. We are given all that we need by Christ. We're given that now. It's something we experience presently, and it's completely fulfilled when Christ reigns in a new heaven and new earth. The people then, just like people now, thought that what we all wanted was to be on top, to be strong. They thought the Messiah was going to usher in a reign where the Jews would be number one, the strongest, and this king would conquer all other kings. And yet Jesus comes in a whole different perspective. He comes as a suffering servant. He comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey as opposed to a big stallion. Jesus comes to serve and to save. He demonstrates what he meant here by coming with meekness. He said he himself was gentle and humble. A whole different mentality than the world's thinking about greatness. One time the disciples were all arguing about who would be the greatest in the kingdom of God. And in Matthew 18, Jesus takes a child and he uses that child as an example. He says, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. This beatitude or this blessing is almost a direct quote of Psalm 37, where the psalmist says, those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. A little while, and the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity. This inheritance is something in our future, and it is something we experience now. In Psalm 22, it says, the meek will be satisfied. In Psalm 25, they will be guided by God. In Psalm 11, they will become wise. Proverbs 11, they'll become wise. In Isaiah 29, they'll be filled with joy. In James 4, they'll be given grace by God. So how do we grow in all this? Well, think about those lists I gave you earlier, the toxins of pride and the antidotes that God uses against that. It could be good to go back and just spend a little time with those lists and maybe do a little personal inventory based on those lists. First of all, are there ways that I see toxins of pride in me? And then secondly, do I see ways that God might be trying to work that out of me, kind of press that out of my character? And maybe sometimes he uses hard things to bring that about. So how do we grow? Well, just let me give you three words. First word is assess. Assess your own thinking about things. Maybe look over those lists. In what ways am I self-focused, self-protective? What makes me anxious or angry? Those can be windows. They can kind of alert me to ways in which I'm trying to grab and hold on to things. Usually we get angry when we feel like something's being taken from us, and we get anxious when we worry that something will be taken from us in the future. And yet Jesus says, blessed are those who are meek, not those who get the most and grab the most, but those who are humble. So assess your own thinking about these things. And then secondly, notice how God might be training you in humility right now. That would be that second list, those antidotes. Are there things that God is using in your life right now to kind of strip you down and show you that you are not fully in charge and that the world does not revolve around you? Those are actually blessings. We usually don't like that kind of discipline, but it's actually good for us. So notice how God might be training you in this. And then thirdly, practice the art of thinking more of others. You can do this almost daily, almost hourly, if you're interacting with anybody on the phone or on Zoom or however you're talking to people. Ask good questions. Listen intently. Empathize well with people. Get inside their thinking, their experience. Feel what they're feeling. Walk in their shoes. Really pay attention to the people in your life. Encourage them. Help them. Think more about others. So assess, notice, and practice. This is something we can do every day. And it works against our tendency toward pride. It helps us to develop this spirit of meekness or strength under control. I love that imagery. Paul had to keep writing about this in all of his letters. In Romans 12, he says, don't think of yourselves more highly than you ought. It also adds honor one another above yourselves. In Galatians chapter 5, he says, through love, serve one another. And in Philippians 2, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. And it comes right back to those beautiful words in Micah chapter 6. He has shown you, oh mortal. There it is, the reminder. We're just humus from dust and returning to dust. He has shown you, oh mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for these great words of Jesus on that mountainside. Thank you for how important they are, how they cleanse our souls and bring us back to what's essential. And this third beatitude, Lord, is one that I want to see take over more and more of my heart. I want to see less of me and more of you and more of a greater concern for helping others, encouraging others, and less about myself. I thank you, Lord, that the true way of inheriting what you have, all that is good for us, is not by grasping, but by surrender. I pray that you would teach us, Lord, what this means in day-by-day interactions, how to be humble as we walk with you and humble in the way we interact with others. Thank you so much for this important lesson as a part of that great sermon. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining me today. God bless your family.
Sing this hymn together. Be thou my vision. Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my life. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Oh, riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Without and your